Today, a deeper dive into rental stress. Hello again, it's Martin North from Digital Finance Analytics. We have now this post covering finance and problem news with a distinctively Australian flavour. Well, the other day I made a long show about mortgage stress and went through some of my stress mapping. And I had a number of positive comments, thank you for that. But I also said that I would, if asked, cover rental stress as a separate conversation. And there were a lot of people in the chat who said, yes, please, we'd love to see that. So today, I'm just quickly going through the rental stress analysis. Now, just to be clear, this is the same basic approach used in our household surveys, 52,000 rolling through the year. And we look at money in and money out. So do they have enough money to pay for rent and other necessities compared with income coming in to the individual household? And unfortunately, in my analysis, well over 40% of those in rented accommodation are under financial pressure, meaning that they are having to make hard choices about what they spend their hard-earned cash on. And in many cases, the rental payments are something which they have to make, but under duress. That's more than 2 million households in rental stress across the country at the moment. That's as hard as it's ever been, and it's been continuing to rise in recent times. Before I go into the maps, I'll just make the point that there are a couple of worrying trends that I see in the data. The first is that around 5% of households have had a rental increase in the last year, a significant increase well above the rate of inflation, which, by the way, may say something about the fact that the way that the ABS reports inflation isn't necessarily a good guide as to the real lived experience of many Australians. Secondly, we've seen a number of households who've had to move from one rented property to another because the landlord has decided to sell the rented property or has simply decided to put the rent up. And the third thing that we've seen, which is probably even more concerning, is that over the last couple of years, a number of renters have been living in property that was previously Airbnb, because investors can get a bigger return for Airbnb properties. However, what they've now done, those investors, is switch the property back from a long-term rent to a B&B again. And so those short-term lets are generating higher returns, but it means that there's now less property available for those for wanting to rent. And in fact, we know that rental vacancies are very low in many parts of the country. And we also know that rental stress follows on. So with that introduction, I want to show you now some of the data from my maps. So this is the one for the area around Sydney. And I guess the first observation is that, perhaps not surprisingly, there are areas in Western Sydney, close to Blacktown, not far from Liverpool, and down towards Campbelltown, where there are very high counts of those in rental stress. And actually, that quite well mirrors mortgage stress. We also see some areas closer in to the west, around Canterbury and Bankstown, for example, and around towards Parramatta. And we also have a number of hotspots right close in to the city and even down round the Bondi area. So there are a number of hotspots where the number renting are in financial difficulty. And in fact, these counts have been rising in recent times. So now let's have a quick look at the area around Melbourne. And once again, there is a somewhat similar story to that relating to mortgage stress. We do see some pressure close into the centre of Melbourne, particularly around Melbourne 3000. But a lot of the pressures are further out, for example, beyond Greater Dandenong, around Casey, so that's postcodes 3977, for example, and also over towards Wyndham, Point Cook, and Werribee and places like that, where, again, we have a number of households that are actually in rental stress. High numbers, in fact. The darkest colours are 8,000 and above. I'd also make the point that there are other areas around the city where there are reasonably high counts as well. That's partly to do with some density issues, to do with how many people are living in the particular areas, but actually rental stress is quite widely spread in and around the area of Melbourne. And in fact, if we pull out further, we can actually see that the areas where there are issues continues to show. So the conclusion here is that the area around here, around Casey, is really one of the biggest hotspots, but there are others too. Now let's jump over to look at the area around Brisbane. And once again, you find that there's quite a strong correlation between rental stress and mortgage stress. So for example, there are many areas around Ipswich where there are high counts of rental stress, and that was also a high mortgage stress area. There are also other areas closer into Brisbane where, again, we do see some degree of stress, although the absolute counts are lower than in some other places. And if we pull out further, we find that even areas around the Gold Coast, there are also some other areas where, indeed, rental stress is an issue. And one of the factors we see here is people moving up from other parts of the country, coming up into Queensland, and then discovering that rents are very high and going up, and therefore they fall into rental stress. Now, if we go across to Adelaide, once again, we find some correlation between rental stress and mortgage stress, although the story here is a little bit different insofar that there are quite a few areas across the city where there are a number of people in difficulty. Generally, you can see that it's to the north of the city, but also some to the southwest of the city where rental stress is more extreme. But the overall counts, of course, are lower because the population base is lower in South Australia. Now, if we then jump across to Perth, we can see that there is, again, some correlation with mortgage stress. Although actually there's a little bit of a difference because the highest levels of mortgage stress are seen to the north and the south of Perth. Whereas here we are seeing postcode 6163, which is towards Fremantle, where there is a very significant hotspot of rental stress. And there are also other areas closer into the city where again there are certain pockets. And to the north, above Stirling, in postcode, for example, 6061. One of the things that we've seen in Perth is that rents have gone up quite significantly. The vacancy rates are very low. And we've got the switch from Airbnb, which is creating quite a lot of pressure for many households. Now, if we go to Hobart, unfortunately, we also see rental stress here. And again, vacancies are very low. The rents have risen very strongly, and many households are therefore struggling. So we can see that even around Hobart itself, 7,000, there are issues, but going north up towards the Glenorchy area and above, there are some further difficulties too. And again, the total counts are somewhat lower because the population density is lower, but nevertheless, in fact, the proportion of households in some difficulty in rental stress in Tasmania more generally, are rising. And that's a combination of very significant rent rises and very little income growth and, of course, very high costs of living. And finally, we might just look at Darwin briefly, because whilst the total number of households are quite low, once again, we do see some examples of stress, particularly in postcode 810, which is to the north of Darwin. And again, the total count, of course, is a lot lower than in other more densely populated areas. But nevertheless, there are quite a few people who are in some difficulty at the moment. So what do we make of all this? Well, it seems to me that we should certainly be very conscious of the pressure on those who are renting at the moment. The pressures, of course, are partly to do with cost of living, cost of electricity, and getting around, as well as just the shopping. All of those things are definitely creating pressures. But what is the most significant factor is the rise in rents. And certainly we expect to see rents continuing to rise, not least because investors are trying to claw back some of the lost revenue that they made over the last couple of years. Of course, there were rent freezes in a number of locations. I think the other point that's worth reflecting on is that we know a number of households who were in rented accommodation through the lockdowns were given some holidays from making rental repayments. However, it appears to me from my surveys that a number of households are still owing back rent. In other words, the rents weren't forgiven, they were just parked. Now, I think that talks to a lack of clarity about what relief was made available by whom, over what time period. And certainly we are seeing a number of people in rented accommodation who are currently paying existing rent and also back rent to try and pay for what happened over the last couple of years. So that's putting extra pressure on many households. And just to close, I'll make the point that over the election campaign in the last few weeks, I've really heard almost nothing with regard to the pressure on those renting. Of course, a lot of focus on properties. And today, ScoMo announced, for example, the ability to be able to withdraw money from superannuation up to $50,000 or 40% of superannuation to help buy a property. And of course, accounting for leverage, that means that property prices could go up by another $200,000 or something like that. And later you put the money back into super down the track. That, for me, is another example of a misplaced strategy because all it does is to put upward pressure on home prices. And they also announced an extension to 55 years for the superannuation route. If you sell a large property over 55 years of age, you can put up $300,000 in superannuation. Again, playing at the edges, I think. But my point really is that on the rental end of the spectrum, nobody's really talking about how we deal with this. The fact is that rents are rising way faster than income. The cost of living, of course, continues to rise. And whilst we do have some sort of rental proxy in the ABS statistics, it doesn't really deal with new rents. It deals with the portfolio of rents. So we're going to see more rent rises over the next year or two because a lot of people are going to have a rent reset over the next period. In other words, I expect rental stress to go higher almost regardless of what happens to the overall CPI and the general cost of living. This is very bad news. We need a strategic policy to deal with the rental sector as well, and that should include, I think, further construction of community-based housing, but also a question about what the strategy is with regard to property investment and how that actually plays forward. We certainly need more rental accommodation for more households. And I have to say that when the argument from ScoMo ends up with, well, if you can't afford to rent, you should buy, I just put my head in my hands and say, you're living in a completely different world, ScoMo. In the real world, many of those who are renting have no potential to move to buy, even with all the incentives that are there. So we need to deal with the rental situation head on. I'm Martin North from Digital Finance Analytics. Many thanks for watching, and I'll see you again next time.